Welcome to McQueenie Baptist Church. Would you guys stand and worship with us this morning as we praise the Lord? All right, this is an old one, but one of my favorites.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood.
For being here this morning. We are so glad that you're here. If you did not pick up a program on the way in, if you'll just go ahead and raise your hand and someone will bring you one because you're going to need it. There is a connection card that we put in that program. We ask everybody to fill it out, please. Visitors, members alike, if you'll fill that out. That's how we keep record of our attendance here today. There's also a place where you could fill out prayer requests, and somebody will be praying over those prayer requests throughout the week. As a matter of fact, we all need prayer, so if there's something really specific that you'd like, you know, to be prayed for, please write that down. Also, there's a place where you can put in any comments that you would like for our staff to read over. So you have a minute and a half to do that, so go ahead and work on that, and then hang on to it till the end of the service.
Thank you.
you guys stand and worship with us before we start to sing this next song. I just wanted to mention and just to bring up the fact that if there's any sin, if there's anything that you're holding on to, if there's any shame in your heart, that our God is so much bigger. His mercy, God's word says that his mercies are new every single morning. Every morning we wake up, God's mercy is brand new. We strive to be more like him, but we mess up all the time. But his mercy is good. And maybe in this place right now, as we sing this song, maybe someone here needs to hear that they need to lay that down at the foot of the cross, at the foot of the Father, and walk away and leave that sin, leave that shame at the foot of the cross where it belongs, because praise the Lord, his mercy is more.
Amen.
And if you know that in your heart, and you know that to be true, and you've seen that true in your life, then let's worship him this morning. Let's don't just sing this song empty and just words up on this screen. Let's sing it from our heart. We are here to worship him this morning. Let's praise him for who he is and the work that he has done in our lives and is available for others too who may not know this. Let's worship him this morning.
What love could remember no wrongs we have done? Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Since they are made. His mercy is more. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more.
God, that you would purify us, or that you would cleanse our hearts, but that we would come before you with repentance, that we might be washed clean, and that we might be able to fix our eyes on you. Lord, that we would not be dragged down by our sin and our shame as we try to run this race for you and for your glory, God. Lord, right now, I know that your presence is here in this place. Lord, and we know how special and how important it is. So, God, right now, we're listening. Lord, as we open your word, Lord, I pray that you would just help us to understand, Lord, what it is that you want to tell us, Lord, about who you are, God, and the purpose that you have for us. Lord, we know that it is so real and so personal. Lord, we're all in different places, but one thing is true, God, that we all need you. And we all need you, your word, and we all need you to speak to us. God, we thank you that we can come into this place and we can sing your praises and we can glorify you. You are so worthy. Lord, we pray that you've been honored in this place. Lord, continue to guide this time. Lord, we're fixed on you right now this morning, and we're ready. Lord, we love you, and we ask all of these things in your holy name. Amen.
Years ago, I did a funeral for someone, and it was a lady that I'd known when I was a child, and they asked me to come to her funeral, and so I hadn't kept up with her, didn't really know where she was, what happened in her life, but I did. But at the funeral, they played Frank Sinatra singing "I Did It My Way," and right from the start, I went, "Oh no," you know. Just let it be known ahead of time to my family and everything. One song I do not want at my funeral is "I Did It My Way." Because how many of you have tried to do it your way? And you see, you know, how's it working for you, right? So, So today we want to talk about not doing it our way, doing it God's way. That's our objective. And we've been talking about revival and, you know, just because of some things we are seeing in our society, some things we have seen kind of unfolding over the last months, you know, a new movie that was out, you know, the Jesus Revolution. It was about revival, about a revival that took place in our time frame, most of us. And so, you know, and then we've heard about other revivals breaking out in different areas of the country. And I don't know if you've kept up with some of that, but I certainly have. And so I just began to think, you know, what is it? What is revival anyway? What is it? What is our definition? Now, I realize most of us have different definitions or ideas about what that is. Some of you may envision people handling snakes and people falling out on the floor, people jumping over pews and running up and down. I don't know what it is you envision revival. I pointed out to that one so-called revival that we saw here back in the 90s was the people all came to the altar and just fell out laughing on the floor. And I don't know, but I just, when I looked at that, I thought, that's no revival that I've seen anywhere in Scripture. You know, nowhere do I see that in Scripture. So that's the reason for doing this series, just talking about what is revival. And we really approached it from the perspective that revival really, I mean, the very word to revive means that, you know, if someone has fell out on the floor and they're dying, you try to revive them. It means you want to bring them back, bring back their life. You want to restore, revive their life. But it has to be life to begin with for it to be revived. And so we're talking about what is lost. And we began the series with a story about losing my college ring and how God, over the years, restored that. And it wasn't so much about the ring, but it was about the message, I believe, that God was just wanting to show me that the things that are lost, regardless of how impossible it may seem, that God is still in the business of restoring the things that are lost. So we talked about the lost word. We looked at the revival under Josiah. The word of God had been lost, and when they found the word of God, just rediscovered it in the temple, and they began to read it, then a great revival sprang up. A great revival began to take place. We have to restore the word of God to its place of authority and power, not only in our churches, but in our lives. And then we talked about prayer. And no revival, no prayer. I mean, two things have to happen in revivals. One is that the word of God is put back into the central place of authority and power in our lives. The other is that prayer begins to permeate all of our lives and all of the church and everything that we do. Prayer begins to seep in and then go out from God's people. So today I want to talk about another thing that without which we will not have renewal in our lives or revival in our church or spiritual awakening in our country. And that word is repentance. Now, if you look at your outline today, some of you may be going, oh, no. Here's what we got in the outline. We've got words like sinners. We've got repentance. We've got judgment. So, I mean, some of you may be thinking, I might want to check out of here. Nope, you're stuck here now, so please just stay. But we want to talk about the things that the Bible says are important. Not just important, but critical. Amen. If we're going to see renewal in our lives, revival in our churches, and spiritual awakening in our country. Wouldn't you all agree that our nation really needs a spiritual awakening? Wouldn't all of you agree that the churches in America need a spiritual revival? Amen. Would you also agree that you need a renewal in your life? Yes. Okay, then that's where we're at today. So, if you go back to the second Sunday that I was preaching on revival, talking about King Josiah and the revival that took place under his leadership, we also made the point that Josiah's grandfather, remember we talked about his grandfather's name was Manasseh. And the scriptures tell us that he was not one of, but the most evil, wicked king that had ruled in Judah in history. I mean, he was just that bad. And so we're told that not only that he ruled, but that he had led the people astray. He brought a disgrace upon the nation of Judah. And we said that he was so wicked that it was his name, it was his rule, it was his dynasty, his ruling, that God said to the nation of Israel through the prophets that he was going to bring judgment because of the wickedness of Manasseh, named by name. That's who they said. And that was looking forward to the Babylon coming and the conquering Judah, taking everyone into captivity, destroying the temple. All of that was because the final, well, let's put it this way. He wasn't the only one, but he was the final what? The final straw, the straw that broke the camel's back, and God said, I've had enough, judgment is coming. So you look at somebody like that and you think, that is the most wicked person. Remember what we said about Manasseh? He was a wicked man. And yet, we come to the end and we read in 2 Kings, but when you move over to 2 Chronicles, we find that where we left off was not the end of the story. So I want to read 2 Chronicles chapter 33, beginning in verse 9. This is a kind of a parallel passage from 2 Kings. This is in Chronicles about the life of Manasseh. Now, let me just tell you, everything that it says in 2 Kings about Manasseh and what he did and the evil that he did is all right there in 2 Chronicles as well. But it gives us a little further view or vision into his life. Let's read it. Beginning in 2 Chronicles chapter 33, beginning in verse 9. It says, but Manasseh led Judah and the people of Israel astray, so that they did more evil than the nations the Lord had destroyed before the Israelites. What he's saying is that Manasseh, under Manasseh's leadership, the people had become so evil, so wicked in Judah and in Judea, that their sins exceeded the sin of the people that were driven out of Canaan ahead of the Israelites. So they were as bad and now worse than the ones that they had conquered. Continuing. The Lord spoke to Manasseh and his people, but they paid no attention. So the Lord brought against them the army commanders of the king of Assyria, who took Manasseh prisoner, put a hook in his nose, bound him with bronze shackles, and took him to Babylon. In his distress, he sought the favor of the Lord, his God, and humbled himself greatly before the God of his ancestors. And when he had prayed to him, the Lord was moved. The Lord was moved by his entreaty and listened to his plea. And so he brought him back to Jerusalem and to his kingdom. Then Manasseh knew that the Lord is God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word this morning. And we thank you, Lord, that we are reminded that of your great love, that it's so forbearing. Lord, that your love is so much more than our sin. And Father, we pray today that you just speak into our lives. Help us to understand what it is that you want to do in us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So the first thing this morning is, as we look at this, the life of Manasseh, I don't know about you. Have you ever had somebody that you thought, man, this person is so far beyond hope as far as being saved or coming to faith in Christ? I mean, they just seem like they're so far gone that it's impossible. In the first service, I gave an illustration of a cousin of mine, and he, you know, he had his problems, no question about it. And the good news is he ended up being saved in prison. But I thought more after the first service, I thought, you know, what are you talking about your cousin for? As if you never went off the rails. As if you never did anything that would dishonor, that would not glorify God. Now, I came to a place in my life, I surrendered to ministry when I was very young. I was actually 13. When I first felt the call of God to ministry and preach. And I actually preached my first message when I was 13 and was licensed to preach when I was 13. But I did the Jonah deal for a while. Okay, so I ran. But what I'm saying is I can remember spending some time when I was so far away from God, even though I had been saved, being so far away from God that I was writing some things that were honestly, if I were to read them to you, you would be horrified. I mean, just at the total loss of my faith in that point in my life. But guess what? And I would have said, man, that guy, he's too far gone. But no. No, you're not. You're not too far gone. And that's the story that I want you to see this morning. And you know, we sang about it, Evie, our praise team, you know, sang about the love of our God and what he wants to do and how he wants to work in our lives and how he wants to restore us. Because why? Because he loves us. So this morning, I want to bring into the picture, you know, we can't have revival without the Word of God being central. We can't have real revival without prayer permeating the church. And we cannot have revival without repentance. Without repentance. What is repentance? Repentance is simply changing your direction. Now, confession is admitting your sin. Confession is when we say, yes, Lord, I have done this. Confession is when you have slipped out your window at night and your parents come in and ask you, did you go out that window at night? You've got a moment in time there where you can own up, and your parents are waiting to see if you're going to come clean, right? No, I didn't go out that window. Did you, Evie? it's hard being a pastor's child, isn't it? And she's heard this now ever since it happened. It's showed up periodically in my sermons, so never mind that I already saw the leaves that were there on the floor outside in front of the window, busted. But see, God is looking for confession, right? Just like us parents, we want to give our children every opportunity to come clean and to have the right character. And bless her heart, Evie finally got around. She came through, right? She's leading worship today and got a clean heart. Good girl. But we have to go through our changes, right? So this morning, I want to talk about what God wants to do in our lives. Now, I'm here to, you know, these are some terms, and today it seems like sometimes that we just have lost some things that we need to be reminded of. Let me tell you something. Listen, repentance is not just a side issue. Repentance is not just a, you know, a doctrine that we, okay, we may look at. No, repentance is essential to your salvation. Repentance is essential to you being renewed and restored and having the Holy Spirit refill and energize you. Repentance is essential. So let's talk about that this morning. So number one, I want to look at, in this passage, I want to look at number one, a sinner's offense. The sinner's offense, because we are, by the way, who is a sinner? Everybody's a sinner in here. Raise your hand. Okay, those of you that did not raise your hand, you need to do a real check, okay? Because the Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Not one of us is not sinned. We are all sinners. The sinner's offense, look at verse 9. Manasseh led Judah and the people of Jerusalem astray. He didn't lead them in the truth. He didn't lead them in the right. He led them astray. Astray from what? Astray from God. Away from God. By the way, young people, there are a lot of people that can influence you in your lives. And sometimes you're going to wonder, you know, is this a friend I should have? Is this a guy I should date? Is this a girl I should be with? Let me just give you a rule of thumb. If they are leading you in any way, if they're leading you away from your relationship with Christ, if they're leading you in a way that causes you to push Jesus to the margins, they are not right for you. You don't want somebody that's going to lead you astray. So Manasseh led the people of Jerusalem astray. So they did more evil than the nations the Lord had destroyed before the Israelites. We're told in 2 Kings 24, 3 and 4, that I mentioned it a moment ago, in that passage we're told that the destruction coming upon Judah, that God said, I'm going to remove you from my sight. I'm going to remove you from my sight, which meant they were taken away into captivity in Babylon. The temple of God was razed, was torn down, and the nation of Judah disappeared from Israel, from the land of Judah. So that was God's judgment. God's judgment on Manasseh. What was his judgment on him? Well, we're going to talk about that in just a moment. But what was God's response to the offense? That is judgment. God's response to Manasseh's offense was judgment. Verse 10 says, the Lord spoke to Manasseh and his people, but they paid no attention. Did you hear that? God had been speaking to the nation of Israel and to Judah for many years through Jeremiah and Isaiah, and the prophets had been bringing the word to them that God was going to bring judgment on the nation if they continued in the way that they were going. But it says they paid no attention. Can I just tell you that sometimes in church as a pastor, well, let me just do this. I'm gonna give you a little sound effect, and I want you to see if you can identify what this sound effect is. Go ahead, Darren. That was a good one. So what do we got there? Ricochets. Thank you, guys. Ricochets. Okay. Could I just say that sometimes as a pastor over all the many years that I've stood in church and preached, and the sound of the ricochets were just deafening. The spiritual ricochets. God's word glancing off of hard hearts. People that just think, oh, this doesn't apply to me. And the sad thing, we may be going through the motions every day. Going through the motions every day of going to church and studying our Bible, but there's something missing. And when we tend to harden our hearts to the things that speak into the things that are missing in our lives. We don't want to deal with those things. God's judgment came upon the people because of their sin. Verse 11 tells us, so the Lord brought against them the army commanders of the king of Syria, who took Manasseh prisoner, put a hook in his nose, bound him with bronze shackles, and took him to Babylon. Why did they put a hook in his nose? Anybody know? Same reason you put a ring in a cow's nose. Well, once you got that ring in there, you just grab the ring and you can just lead them anywhere you want to go. And so they put a hook in Manasseh's nose and led him from the place of Judah, from Judea, from the presence of God and God's people led him to Babylon. You see, once the hook was in his nose, he could lead him anywhere he wanted to go. And I wonder what is the hook in our nose? What happens when the enemy, what happens when Satan gets a hook in your nose and begins to lead you the other direction? Begins to lead you and pull you where you don't really want to go. You think you do, but you don't. Let me ask you this. What would it take? Come on now. I'm talking just to you personally. What would it take to truly turn your heart back to God? Not pretense, but really turn your heart back to God. What would it take to take you back to that place where you first trusted him as Savior and you were filled with the Holy Spirit and you felt his power and his glory and most of all his grace in your life, and you felt the motivation and the power and the presence, and you wanted to serve, and you wanted to you were motivated and passionate. So that's a sinner's offense. Let's look at the sinner's distress. Three words, it's easy to on this passage. On verse 12, it says, in his distress, talking about Manasseh, in his distress. Did you know that falling away from God and God's judgment and his discipline in our lives is meant for a purpose? That's why we call it discipline. That's why it's not punishment, it's discipline. And God was disciplining the nation of Israel. God was bringing discipline, judgment down on the nation of Judah. And I found many times in my life that I've had my life get into a place where the first thing we have to do is stop and just ask the question, because not all problems in our lives are because of judgment or God's discipline. Okay, hear me, it's not. But when life has gone the wrong direction, it's a good idea to sit down in the presence of God and just simply say, God, is this, you know, where am I? Is this have anything to do with where I am spiritually right now? Are you trying to get my attention? Are you trying to tell me something? Let me ask you, what would it take to get your attention? He was in distress. God's response, patience. Now, when I say patience, patience in the judgment, because it would be so easy. See, when we see somebody that we love struggling, when we see somebody that we love suffering, what do we want to do? We want to relieve their suffering. We want to lift them up out of their suffering. We want to help them. But here we find God looking at his people and loving him, loving his people. You understand, God loves us. God loves the people then, and he's watching, but he's being patient to let what he is doing in their lives, the discipline that he's bringing, the chastisement that he's bringing down to them, he's giving time to let that chastisement, let that discipline have its effect in our lives. That's why sometimes when things are going so bad and we pray, oh God, could you just take this off of me? And he says, no, not until you open your eyes and see what it is I want you to see. And by the way, moms, dads, aunts, uncles, grandparents, do not intervene or interfere in what God is doing in a person's life. How many times have we prayed for somebody? Oh God, we're praying that they will come to faith, but they're so far away. Their lives are so disobedient. We're praying for them, we're praying, and then God begins to do some things, and we go, wait a minute. I don't want them to suffer. I don't want them to have any real pain. I want you to do this without all of that. No, it doesn't work that way. And so what we need to do, just like we pray about what is God doing in my life right now, is this just a part of life, or God, are you trying to get my attention? We pray that prayer. What about looking at your loved ones? What about the people you're praying for? God, is this what you're doing? Is this your discipline? Is this the chastisement that you're bringing, trying to get their attention, to turn their heart? Is that what you're doing? Then if it is, then I need to keep my hands off. I don't need to intervene because I'll be disturbing your plan, your purpose. So we need to remember that and pray about that. Psalm 51:8. Remember the story of David? David, when he sinned with Bathsheba, and he... That wasn't even the worst of it. He sinned with Bathsheba, but then he had her husband killed on the battlefield to cover his sin. So all of that took place, and then the prophet Nathan, God finally sent the prophet Nathan to David, and he put his finger in his face, and he said, "The man, you're the man, you're the one who has brought this about. You're the sinner." And of course, David, to his credit, this is why we would say, when they said David was a man after God's own heart, it wasn't because David was sinless. It was because when he was confronted with his sin, when God was able to speak into his life, David repented. David listened, and he put into action repentance, turning away from his sin. I love it when he says in Psalm 51, by the way, Psalm 51 is David's prayer of repentance after his sin with Bathsheba. But this is what he said, "Let me hear joy and gladness." Let me hear joy and gladness. What is the implication? The implication is the joy and gladness is gone. Okay? "Let me hear joy and gladness." Look at this part. I love this. "Let the bones you have crushed rejoice." What is he saying? David is saying that this judgment, this chastisement that has come down upon me is like the breaking of bones. Sounds pretty painful, doesn't it? David is saying, the bones that you've broken, the things that your chastisement and your judgment has shown me, what you're working in, it's but not because you hate me, it's because you love me. Why do we discipline our children? Not because we hate them, but because we love them. David has said, listen, the chastisement that you brought down on me has finally turned my heart. And so that, by the way, notice that the end result of the judgment was joy and gladness. Joy and gladness. That's what David is shooting for, joy and gladness. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10, "Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret, but worldly sorrow brings death." Two types of sorrow. One is worldly sorrow, the other is godly sorrow. What's the difference? Well, really, only in the outcome. Worldly sorrow is sorrow that we experience without God. Some of you experience joy like that experience your pain and your hardships in life just like that. You have no one to turn to. And all you can do is ask, what am I going to do about this situation that I'm in? Godly sorrow recognizes that God is present in your life. Godly sorrow, it says, leads to repentance that brings to salvation. Look at this, and leaves no regret. I don't know about you, but that's the kind of sorrow I desire. Something that's going to actually change my direction. In his distress, what did he do? Well, we're going to talk about that next. The sinner's repentance. So let's look at it again. We find this in beginning in verse 12. Because it says, in his distress, he sought the favor of the Lord his God and humbled himself greatly before the God of his ancestors. Three things that I noted that he did. Number one, he sought God's favor. It means he prayed. It means he cried out to God. He began to seek the face of God. Do you know that's where it all begins? We come to a place where we just go, I don't know what's going on in my life. I don't know what happened. I don't know why I'm the way I am. I don't know why I'm doing the things that I do. I've got to change, and my life is a mess. We come to the place of acknowledging that, and we turn from those things and just begin to seek the face of God. Just begin to look for him. How many of you in this morning, I wonder how many of you are just looking, seeking the face of God? Because if you do, the Bible says if you seek his face, you will find him when you search for him with all your heart. So he sought the favor of God. Number two, he humbled himself before God. Here is the king, the great king Manasseh, who had done all of these things wrong, had all of the sin that was on his tab. But he humbled himself before God. Now, how do we know that? Well, the Bible tells us that he humbled himself. But also we know that by the response that God gave. So he humbled himself. He bowed before the Lord. Number three, he poured out his brokenness before God in prayer. We don't know what he prayed. I don't know what Manasseh prayed. we actually have a recorded prayer, the prayer of Manasseh, that's recorded, but not in Scripture. It's in a in one of the books of the Apocrypha. It's not a book that we had recognized as authoritative. Wasn't included in the canon. In fact, all scholars say that this prayer was clearly written at some time just before Jesus' birth. So it's not really the prayer of Manasseh. But here's the thing: when you read it, I was going to share it with you, but I thought no, because the prayer is everything we would probably think would be in the prayer like that. Oh God, great and mighty, powerful God, recounting all the miraculous things that God had done in the life of Judah and the people. Praise and adoration, and then deep confession of his sin, recognizing and owning up and acknowledging his sin that he had committed before God, and then repenting and saying, I'm going to turn from these things. I'm not going to be that person anymore. And we know that God heard him because of God's response to him. We're told in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, that it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and that is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. This passage tells us that it's not by our efforts and our work that we were saved. Okay, that's important. We're not saved by our efforts and our work, and we're not kept, and we're not renewed and revived by our works. So you see, we need to kind of move away from the performance and about the behavior base. And behaviors are important. Those are the indications of sin in our lives. Don't get me wrong. But I want you to see the main issue here. The main issue is our relationship to our Creator. Did you know I think one of the worst sins that we can do as a believer? You know, we can name all kinds of sins, and I'm sure we all have our lists of sins. But I think one of the worst sins against God is just indifference. And we just treat him indifferently. You know, we not important enough to listen to or talk to, not really important enough to invite into our lives or to even go and study his word to find out how we are to live this life and what he wants from us. Just indifference. In fact, if you go to the Old Testament, the New Testament and book of Revelation, Jesus has something to say. The church in Ephesus, when he was writing his letters to the churches, the church in Ephesus were one of the greatest churches about doctrine and staying true to the word of God and weeding out those that were liars and charlatans. And yet, Jesus said, you've done all these things, but this one thing I have against you, you know what it was? Simply this, that you have left your first love. It is all about our relationship. See, that's why God was coming down so hard on Manasseh. He was coming down hard on Manasseh because Manasseh was leading the people astray. The Bible says that rather than our works, that if we confess our sins, admit it, come clean, confess our sins, that he is faithful and he is just, and he will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The same way we come, we get revived, the same way we get saved. We just come to him, we acknowledge our sinfulness, we confess. And we just ask him to come in, and we begin to have communion with him again. So what is God's response? God's response to our repentance is forgiveness and restoration. The first part of forgiveness could take place while Manasseh was still in prison. But I want you to notice I said repentance and restoration because in this particular story, that's what happens. God forgives Manasseh, but then he also restores him. Look at the passage, verse 13. It says, and when he prayed to him, that is the Lord was moved by his entreaty. I love that. The Lord was moved by his entreaty. Did you know that you can literally move the heart of God? What is he looking for? What moves his heart is your honesty and your integrity. It's the truthfulness. It's the brokenness. It's the repentance. But we don't stay in that place. That's why we're sometimes so afraid that we think somehow we're going to get out in this place and we're going to stay there. But God, the end result of repentance is to lift you up and find joy and gladness in your heart. Listen to what it says. And when he prayed to him, the Lord was moved by his entreaty and listened to his plea. So he brought him back to Jerusalem and to his kingdom. Then Manasseh knew that the Lord is God. I think Manasseh knew that the Lord is God, not just because he brought him back into his kingdom. I think he knew that the Lord was God because of the experience he had with him in that jail cell. It was the experience he had with God when he was in that prison cell that changed his perspective. Now, I don't know what's going on in your lives today. I don't know what may be taking place or what hardship you may be experiencing. First thing I would do is sit down and say, God, where is my relationship with you right now? Have I just been indifferent to you? Worse, have I just rebelled against you and completely walked away? What is it God is wanting to show you? You know, the scripture says in the last verse, 1 Timothy 2:8 says, therefore, I want the men everywhere to pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or disputing. We sang that this morning. God wants us to lift up holy hands. That doesn't necessarily talking about the action of lifting hands. It's the holy hands part. It's the repentance, the relationship. That when our hands are lifted to God, and if you do that, that's fine. If you don't, that's fine too, because it's about your heart. It's not about your hands. Okay? This morning, I just want to ask you, what will it take? What will it take to bring you back to the place that God wants you to be? And you know what? If you're living that life, you're living the life God wants you to live, you're walking in faith, and you're serving, and you have an active and vibrant relationship with God, then praise God for that. Let your faith be seen by others. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Thank you for this time together this morning. We ask God that you would guide us in this time as we come together and, Lord, look for you to speak into our lives. Lord, we just want to make sure that our hearts are right before you. Lord, that it is not about our performance. What you're looking for in us is not does not begin with what we can do, but who we are to you. Lord, I desire that my relationship be complete, total, where it should be. And I pray that for your people. Lord, I pray today for your people. Lord, that they would be totally sold out to you. Lord, their hearts would be soft and pliable. Lord, that your word could find its place in our lives. Speak, we're listening. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, would you stand with us as we go into this time of invitation this morning? I don't know what God may be saying to you, but this is your time right now to respond to whatever it is God is speaking into your life. The altar is open. If you just want to come up here and pray, or if you have a prayer, if I can pray for you, I'd be glad to do that. Maybe you need to trust Christ. Maybe you need to make the giant step today of just saying yes to Jesus for the very first time and giving your heart to him. Because all you have to do is believe by faith. And he will come into your life and he will change you forever. If you'd like to do that today, I'll be here to pray with anybody. So let's worship together right now. Cast down our idols. Amen. You can be seated. I just want to say that I believe that generation is right here present today. I believe that generation is here. So, expecting a lot. Connection cards. Pass those things to the center aisle, if you would. Those we filled out at the beginning of the service, if you would pass those in, we're going to pick those up right now. Just a few announcements I want to share with you. First of all, the first and most important thing on the agenda is an ordination service for Connor Palmer this evening. We will be doing that at 5 o'clock right here in the auditorium. So I want to encourage everybody, really important that you come and be a part of this, service tonight, because the heart of the ordination service is the church verifying and saying yes, that we see the call of God in this man. And so you need to be here to voice that support and do that. So 5 o'clock this evening. Also, boy, this is really good news. I just wanted to share this with such joy. The Christmas pictures are ready. Yes. Is Liz in here? Where's? No, she's not in here right now. No. Oh, there she is with the bright purple shirt. And Liz said the church Christmas snail pictures got done. So anyway, Liz, we're so happy. And by the way, getting to see these pictures after this time, what a great fun that was. I started to suggest that we just wait till July. You know, we could have Christmas in July. But no, this is good. And you know, there's no rush on these. These are going to be, they're available. They're out in the foyer. If you had your picture made with Santa Claus, you can go out there and pick up your pictures. They're on the bench out there. So please do that. I've got mine already. Okay. Then a car show, that's coming this coming weekend. This next weekend is our car show, and it's going to be from 9 o'clock to 2 o'clock on Saturday. We are asking everybody to come out and support this. By the way, if you signed up to volunteer and you have a T-shirt, they took your T-shirt size, then those T-shirts are going to be available for pickup right after this service in the fellowship hall. So you can go by and pick those up, if you will, before you leave today. So please be in prayer about this. Pray that we could really have a successful show, reach our community, and really make a difference in some people's lives, okay? And then finally, last but not least, I have a newcomers class coming Wednesday, May the 10th. A lot of times I do these on Sunday evenings. This time I'm doing it on Wednesday evening. So it'll be Wednesday from 6:30 to 8 o'clock, and we'll meet in what used to be the youth room right down at the end of the hallway this way. So come on that evening, and we'll be sure that you find your way. 6:30 to 8 o'clock on Wednesday, May the 10th. Newcomers class is where we answer questions about our church, kind of give you information that you need to know in order to make an informed decision about church membership. So great time together. I teach the class. It's an hour and a half long. Hope you'll be able to join us. There is a sign-up sheet on the table at the back of the auditorium, so if you would sign up to let us know. Well, all right. Thank y'all for coming this morning. Let's all stand together. Pray that God continues to do a work in your life as we go out of here today and step out into this world again, that people could see Jesus Christ in our lives, okay? So let's bow our heads this morning as we go to the Lord in prayer. I'm going to ask Buster, if he would, Buster Strain, if he would lead us in closing prayer.